Really feel home for the first time in a church. We feel like the message is going forth.
Yes.
When you look at the book of Revelation, there are numerous angels, messengers, that constantly descend from heaven to earth.
Yes.
Okay, they are the words of the Lord going deep into your heart. So every time that you actually receive the word, you are entertaining an angel. Okay? That's why Hebrews chapter 13 says, now you have come to this new Jerusalem, to Mount Zion, new Jerusalem, the city of the living God, to the innumerable number of angels, to the spirits of the righteous that are perfected, to Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant, and to the blood of the new covenant. That speaks better than the blood of Abel. So he says, once he spoke, and he said, once again I will speak, and I will shake not only the earth, but heaven and earth. Because he wants to make a new heaven and new earth. Which means he wants to make the old to grow old and become obsolete. So what is new can manifest itself. And he says, therefore, let me just make sure I quote it correctly. It says, therefore, let brotherly love continue. Because the brotherly love of Abel could have saved Cain from the wicked conscience that was tormenting him day and night. And Abel loved his brother. And when God came to Cain, he said, where is your brother? And he said, am I my brother's shepherd? Which means we are supposed to be one another's shepherds. The shepherds of one another's souls. Taking them by the hand and lead them to the fountain of living waters. Whenever someone is going astray and allowing the wicked conscience to take them away from the Lord, to bring them back and say, what are you doing? He doesn't need anything from you. Yeah. He's all love and you are accepted. You don't need to bring any sacrifice because he never required any sacrifice from anyone.
Yeah.
Even to Israel, you can read it. He says, when I brought your fathers out of Egypt, you can see this in Jeremiah, Amos, did I ever ask them for sacrifice? Do I eat their flesh? Do I drink their blood? But the answer is no. So then why do you bring sacrifice to me? When did I ask for a sacrifice? Never. But this I desire, a contrite spirit. Someone that can come to the Lord and say, I look unto you, not to myself. You're making a sacrifice. You're allowing that which was to become a stumbling block to you to remain on the altar, and you come boldly to the throne of grace. So right after that, this is Hebrews chapter 13. After verse 1 that says, let brotherly love continue. He says, do not forget to entertain strangers, for by doing so, some have unwittingly entertained angels. Okay, so you entertain angels because you never, you always see the person that is speaking in the flesh, and you never know when the Lord is speaking. Because he said, when you want to speak, don't premeditate on what you want to say, because the Holy Spirit will give you at the moment what you need to speak.
Yeah.
That's why I have, basically, I'm not any more conscious of what I'm saying.
Yeah.
Because when I want to think of what I want to share, I might think there might be someone here that has a problem with this and they may be offended. Mm-hmm. And the message of the gospel is offensive, mm-hmm. very offensive, to the point that the disciples left Jesus, even the 12. He came to the 12 and he said, do you also want to leave? So that means the message of the gospel is so against the carnal mind, which always wants an answer and can't live in the mystery itself. To say, I just look at this beauty, I know there is so much more, but I worship you. Because when you do that, things you will experience that is beyond understanding. And later you will understand. How could you know the love of God that says is beyond understanding except if you experience it first? Because if it's beyond understanding, you can't understand it to receive that love. So that means there has to be a place of me being, again, unveiled, naked before him, face to face with him. And in that intimacy with him, I then receive a gift. And later, I will unbox it. And then later, I will be able to even know how to use it. Now, the one who knows me knows what kind of gift I need. And I will subject myself to his love. That's it. So that's so vital, so important for us to understand that this is not an intellectual religion. This is the intimate inner course of the Spirit of God with us, within us. So when we come together, the spirits of righteous that are perfected are already with one another, and they are forming a city called the New Jerusalem. Okay? So that's why people can be in a room, and some only are looking at a man in flesh, and some go beyond the flesh, look into the spirit of the man. And they hear not the flesh that speaks, but the spirit that is speaking. And they receive the blessing because the rain is coming. And the earth that opens itself will receive a blessing. Make sense? These are all Hebrews chapter 6. Because Jesus said, be perfect as your Father is perfect, for he causes his rain to fall both on the just and the unjust, on the righteous and unrighteous. So first of all, that shows us he never gives rain based on what you do. The rain has been coming. It's up to, I don't want to say up to me because again, it makes me to do something, but it says it's a matter of the earth to not to be so basically hard that doesn't receive the rain to go in and bear fruit, but to be an earth that actually allows the rain to go in. Okay, the coming of the Lord is like a rain. James chapter 5. The coming of the Lord is like a rain. Why do you think Jesus comes on the cloud? What do you think the cloud is? We just read, the spirits of righteous made perfect. So when the Lord comes, he comes with the spirits. So he says, I have given you the early rain, and I will give you the latter rain. Why? Because he wants the seed that is inside of us to bear fruit.
Yeah.
What is the seed? The Christ.
Yes.
Make sense?
Yeah.
Okay. So, if you look at actually the word, if you look at the Hebrew word for that verse, it says, I have given you, the translation says, I have given you the early rain moderately. But when you look at the translation, it says, I have given you the early rain, righteousness. Righteousness is the former rain. Hosea, I think. Let's actually go there. Actually, it's the book of Joel. Okay, chapter 2. And you know that Jesus, when he talked about the parable of the sower and the seed, he said it's actually a parable of the soil, not the sower and the seed, because the only thing that is changing is the soil. And he said the soil is the heart,
yes.
Right? So he said you plant the seed in the soil, in the heart. So if the soil is the heart, the land must be your body, right? Okay. Chapter 2, verse 21. Fear not, O land. So, Joel, chapter 2.
Yeah.
Not Job. Not Job. Yes. That's it. Thank you. Okay, fear not, O land. So, you're speaking to you, the land. Be glad and rejoice.
Yeah.
That's like the gospel. Always, from the beginning to the end. Adam and Eve, afraid, hidden themselves. Jesus comes, do not be afraid.
Yeah.
Peace to you, constantly. So it's man that constantly goes into fear and he says, don't fear. Joshua, do not fear.
Yeah.
Abraham, fear not.
Mm-hmm.
Moses, do not fear. Paul, do not fear. Pastor Vin, do not fear. Rose, do not fear. Do not fear. That's the message of the gospel, because we have been in the fear of death all our lifetime.
Right.
He came to set us free from that fear. Now he says, fear not, O land, be glad and rejoice, for the Lord has done marvelous things. He's not going to do it. He has done. Just like Jesus rose again from the dead and the disciples are depressed and they can't see the fulfillment of the promise in front of their eyes standing. And they're still in their own sorrow that he died. No, he raised. He has done marvelous things. Open your eyes and see. So he says, don't fear. Why? Because there is something that has been done.
Yes.
So you are being awakened to the work that the Lord has done. So you can realize that you can be in rest.
Yes.
Okay, next verse. Verse 22, do not be afraid, you beasts of the field. Okay, let me just go on. If I stop on every word, we would actually not have enough time. For the open pastures are springing up and the trees bears fruit. Sounds like blessing. Sounds like everything that God said in the beginning, be fruitful and multiply, the beast of the field, the trees, everything is being in that position. Sounds like the garden is finally the garden.
Yes.
It's not anymore desolate, it's not a wilderness, it's not a place without water. Sounds like there are waters flowing.
Yeah.
Sounds like the blessings of the Lord are coming. Sounds like the Lord's work is being performed in our land. The fig tree and the vine yield their strength. Be glad then, you children of Zion. I'm speaking to the children of Zion.
Yes.
Because you have come to Mount Zion.
Yes. Yes.
You're not going to go. You have come. We are right now in Zion. Jesus said, the Son of Man is the one who is in heaven. Right now. And he didn't say, I am in heaven. He said, the Son of Man is in heaven.
Right.
Why do you think Jesus would use terms that were generic and not specific to himself? Because he came to reveal things about us. He didn't come to show how amazing he is. Did you notice that? He came to show how amazing we were created. Marvelous are the works of his hands. Who is the work of his hand? Because he is the Lord eternal from the beginning. He didn't need to be glorified. It was we who were needed to be glorified. But when you are glorified, he is glorified in you. Because his work is being performed. It's like the father who wants to do everything for his children. And finally when they receive it, and they go according to the plan that he has for them. And when he sees the graduation, he is being glorified in the eyes of everybody else in the family.
That's
the joy that you're giving him. That's how we bring pleasure to him. So now here he says, be glad then, you children of Zion, and rejoice in the Lord your God. How many times Paul in the book of Philippians says, therefore I say rejoice. Again, rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord always. Therefore, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, with thanksgiving and supplication, make your requests known to God. And the peace of God will guard your heart and mind. Therefore, rejoice in the Lord. We are in Christ who makes us able to do all things in the midst of our inabilities. So rejoice in the Lord your God. Isaiah says, speaking of the gospel, he says, behold your God. We need to really behold him.
Yeah.
We have beheld ourselves enough.
Yeah.
Right?
Yes.
Like, and now, honestly, when I'm here, I'm looking at you. I'm not looking at you. I'm looking at you with capital U. With capital Y.
Amen.
Because you are one with him. And I will not dare to speak against you. I will not dare to bring a railing accusation against you. If someone needs to rebuke you, it's the Lord, not me. And he rebukes those who he loves. Not to destroy them, to return them from the way that they have gone astray into the way of life.
Amen.
Because he loves
Hallelujah.
Everyone.
Yeah.
So I'm not here for destruction, I'm here for edification.
Mm. Yes.
And we are. You see how everything, even in the earthly realm that is happening, is a manifestation of the unseen. We look at things that are going on in technology and all of that, and I understand things sometimes go so extreme in a direction that they should not go. But who do you think gives the idea to people? Who do you think is giving the idea of computer, tablets, or basically vehicles, or airplanes, or all these things? These are all the spiritual realities that are manifesting themselves on the earth. So do you think Apple was so clever to name their thing a cloud? That you can upload everything somewhere and then you have access to that every place? You are being surrounded with such great cloud of witnesses.
Yeah.
You can download.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah.
This is something actually the Lord showed us 3 years ago that I don't fully understand it, but I understand the concept. That's why he does things in the natural realm, movies. I mean, we have divided ourselves from culture, from Hollywood, from everything, and we think these things are evil. And honestly, some of the movies are pure evil. I'm not talking about that, but we shouldn't be actually throwing everything away just because there are some evil things in them. Yeah. It's like when we say the law of Moses brought death, yes, but I shouldn't put the law of Moses in a way completely, because he says the law is spiritual, which means that reveals to me things.
Yeah.
I'm reading the Old Testament and I see Jesus in them.
Yeah.
I read the same exact verses that God said, you shall not commit adultery, and I understand, oh my goodness, what a God. He's not talking about that kind of committing adultery. Not that he's pleased with that, not that he's condoning that, never, ever. But he never condemns anyone for those things. And he says, the reason you're committing that kind of adultery, because you have already committed adultery to the Lord in your heart.
Yes.
So why not put the axe at the root? Why not receive the grace of God that causes every root of bitterness in our heart instead of springing up to go away completely? So you can experience the planting of the Lord in yourself, the trees of righteousness. So when we speak of the cloud of witnesses, he says it's a place that there are some that are actually, their conscience is purged. They see themselves one with the Lord. And they don't worship themselves. Because everybody else before that is worshiping themselves, although they think they worship God. The image they are taking upon themselves is the image of the corruptible man, not the image of the incorruptible God. Remember Jesus talked to people and they said, should we pay tax to Caesar or not? And he says they were tempting him and he said, give me a coin. And he looked at it and he said, whose image is on this? They said, Caesar's. He said, okay, therefore give this one to Caesar, but give to God what is God's. He's saying, whose image is on you?
Yes.
So give yourself to the one whose image is on you.
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Whose inscription is on you? Whose writing is on you? Whose name is written on your forehead? The book of Revelation speaks of a place that finally see themselves as the paradise of God, and their Father's name is written on their forehead, and they see him face to face. You see, our gospel has been backward until now. He says, this is the way, and we say, no, this is the way. And we think this is really what God says. He says, come to me, and we go this way, and we think we are going to God. Just as Rose said yesterday, he says, you are forgiven, believe that you are forgiven. And we say, if you believe, you will be forgiven. He says, I came to show you you were forgiven, and you say, he came that we might be forgiven. Always backward.
Yes.
He says, because our sins he had overlooked, he came. We say, he came so he could take the wrath of God upon himself, so God's vengeance could be satisfied, so a God that has no self-control can finally be in control. That I can finally have peace. We think he's our enemy.
Yeah.
And he says, you've been my enemy in your wicked mind. The word wicked is profound if you look at the word wicked. Exactly. It's the word that is being used for toiling. Who is the first one that toiled? Whose conscience was so defiled that he was told that his fruit will be thorns and thistles instead of the fruit of life? Who came to that place of toil and annoyance? Adam. So what is the wicked conscience? The conscience that wants to always please God, to be accepted. Please God so he can be received. Please God so he can be blessed. He wants to trade with God. Yes. He doesn't understand family.
Yes.
So, in God's perspective, from the beginning to the end, he thinks he's so good. And we divide him into Old Covenant and New Covenant. Why? Because we still see through the veil. Scriptures that are written. Now name them. Children were killed, murdered, Noah's flood, Moses, Pharaoh, all those things. And he says, I understand your struggle. Close that portion of the book for now. Even close the book itself for now. Look unto Jesus. And then go back and read it.
That's good.
And if you don't see Jesus, if you don't see God look like Jesus, then close it. Then again look at Jesus, because you know already the scriptures and the stories, right? You know Jesus. You know that Jesus, I think, not for me. For me it was the Father first that I realized is so good, and I had problem with Jesus when I wanted to actually give my life to him. But I realized that other people have problem with the Father. They are good with Jesus. Because they see him healing, you know, blessing, casting out demons, raising from the dead, blessing people, all of that. But they see the Father as the one that is mentioned in the Old Testament, Yahweh. Mm-hmm. And they say, well, God is still, you know, God. He can do anything that he wants, absolutely, but he can't go beyond his nature. All things are. But the thing is, we don't understand everything yet. So what is the wise thing to do right now? Proverbs says the wise is the one who is actually quick to listen, slow to speak. It's being quoted in James. We read that yesterday. The wise is the one who asks for wisdom, not the one who has wisdom. That's why the scripture says the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. What is the fear of the Lord? I know nothing. Job came to a place, he said, I'm not going to speak about anything anymore. Once I had heard about you, but now I see you face to face. You speak. I want to hear. He said, finally you came to your senses. Everything restored. You see, when we don't allow him to speak to us, we become hard in our heart. And we project what we believe on God. The hardness of heart is the only problem that man has had from the beginning. And do you know that, I think it's Mark 16, that Jesus, when he's raised from the dead, he comes and he rebukes his disciples for the hardness of their heart, that they did not believe those who talked about seeing Jesus resurrected. So he rebukes not because of what you do, he rebukes because of what you believe.
Yes.
So he loves you and he needs to get the heart of stone out of your heart. Because without the heart of faith, the heart of trust, with the heart of confidence and courage and boldness, you can't receive from God. And when you don't receive from God, he's grieved.
Yes.
He's not pleased. That's why he says, without faith, you can't please God. Okay, something maybe I can share with you. You know about... basically the story of God. We have people over the years from the beginning, of which we have, let's say, Adam. And then we have people like Enoch. And then we have people like Paul. And in each of these stories, we read something about God walking with man and man walking with God. For example, about those who were in the garden in the beginning, Adam and Eve, he says, they heard the voice of God walking, we shared yesterday this, in the spirit of the day. So he says they heard the voice of God. Walking in spirit of the day. So the voice walks in the spirit. Jesus said in John chapter 3 to Nicodemus, he said, the wind, the spirit, blows wherever it wishes. You don't basically, you hear the sound, the voice of it. You hear the voice of the Spirit, but you don't know where it comes from and you don't know where it's going. That's why it's very important for me to learn over 8 years, when he's moving, I will move with him.
Yes.
So when then he wants to go this way, I will go with him. And then if he wants to take me this way, I will go with this. That's why yesterday you saw I jumped from Revelation to Genesis and then to back to Revelation and then to Hebrews and to all of that. For some, maybe they say, what are you talking about? But I'm following the pattern of thoughts that make sense in the spirit.
Yeah. Yeah.
They don't make sense in the flesh.
Yeah.
So the spirit thought are different than the flesh thoughts.
Yeah.
So the Spirit searches all things and reveals those things to me. Me. Okay? The Spirit searches. That means I don't know it, but the Spirit knows it. So the Spirit, when he searches those things, and he says, as many as are led by the Spirit, they are sons of God. Sons of God are those who have relied on saying, I don't know anything except what I hear the Father is saying. So the reason I'm moving that way is because I'm not even thinking. It just comes out of my mouth. And that's why Rose didn't know what she was going to say yesterday. And she shared it. She had not studied that for herself that way. I had not seen that scripture about Cain and Abel that way. And that completely opens the book of 1 John, by the way. But that's how the Spirit does. And if he doesn't do those things, we're always in something called 12 years of Christianity, and we all grumble and complain, why there is nothing new? Why there is no joy? Well, because we resist the Holy Spirit as our forefathers did. For 40 years, in the days of temptations and trials, when they tempted God, not God tempting them. And he says, God said, well, if you continue this way, you will never enter into my rest. Because later he says in Hebrews 3, he says, because we know it was because of unbelief that they did not enter. Yeah. So as long as there is a day called today, he says, today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your heart, but believe. It is his good pleasure to give you the kingdom. It is his good pleasure to give you the Holy Spirit. It is his good pleasure that all that you have flows from him. It is his good pleasure that your soul be fed by the pleasure of the Lord, Eden. Now he says the way this works is by walking with God. But how do you walk with God? In the voice of the Spirit of the day. Now, Adam didn't, because the moment he heard the voice in the Spirit, he hid himself in the flesh.
Yes.
You know the story, right?
Yes.
He says, I was afraid, I covered myself. Now, but there is a man, the seventh from this wicked man. What did he do? Enoch walked. With God. He lived 365 years. Sounds like the completion. And he says, he, because of walking in the Spirit of the day with the voice of the Spirit, what was the result? God took him. But before that, he says, because he was no more. He was caught up into the Spirit. He became the Spirit. Not anymore flesh. It's like it's like this. Normal day. Because these are all these are abstract scriptures that are profound.
Yes.
These are about the life of a man that lived for 365 years, and we just ignore it so easily. But this is our life. If you and I, our lives were supposed to be written, this is how God would mention us. Masud lived with God, in God, and walked with God 365 years. And I'm like, hey, Lord, what does this mean? Where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? I don't understand it. I walk with the Lord in the Spirit of the day. Not in the flesh of the day. In the Spirit of the day. And then he says, at some point, he says, my son, you were crucified with me. And I say, then it is no longer I who live. He says, you're cut up. I took you. You are no longer. Paul says in Galatians chapter 2, the next verse, it is no longer I. The word I in Greek is ego. It is no longer the ego that lives. For I was crucified with Christ, but yet I live. But the one that lives, the new I, is Christ in me. So I walk with him. He says, Paul says in the same book, he says, therefore, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the desire of the flesh. How do you walk with this? How do you walk in the Spirit? We have examples. Voice. Today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your heart. Lord, what do you mean I was crucified? You were crucified. Well, I wasn't there. You were crucified. Well, you were crucified 2,000 years ago. But I was born 40 years ago. You were crucified. Okay. Let it be done to me according to your word.
Yeah.
I'm going to be, I'm not going to be a husband to do this for me. I'm going to be remaining a virgin soul. So you do it to me. And then the seed is planted. I don't understand it. I just keep the seed of what I heard. And that he's faithful, the faithful witness in the cloud of witnesses to send the rain for the seed. Just keep the seed, because the seed does not try to bear fruit. Does not try to grow. Paul says, who is Paul and who is Apollos? Who is Pastor Vin and who is Rose or who is Masood? We are co-workers with God and you are God's field. Some plants, some waters. But who makes things to grow? God. So when God said, be fruitful and increase and multiply, what did he say? Did he say, try to go and do it? Now you have one church, make it 200 churches? Or maybe the Lord added to the church daily. So if you walk this way, you remain a virgin church. But if you walk on the other way, that is called a harlot. Because goes to those who would be able to give because of what I can do. Harlot.
Yeah.
And I honestly believe, I don't know, maybe people that lived 1,000 years ago believed the same thing, because this is something, although it is corporate, but it is also individual. But this is what I wanted to say. I believe we can really step into these things. We can step into the place that the Lord himself walks in fullness. We can. I believe we can, because it's not me. If it was me, I would think, let's use an earthly example. Let's say you have a debt equal to 100K. Okay, in the normal situation, you go get a job, and they pay you maybe, I don't know, 70, 80, 50, 100 a year. And then, of course, some of it is going to tax, some of it is going to basically for your expenses, and maybe you can save a bit, and you can use that saving of maybe 10K per year, or 15, or 20 per K to pay out your debt. And the more, actually, because it's also adding interest, you won't be able to now pay this out in 5 years. Maybe you will do it in 8 years. That's the natural realm. But the Spirit is not like that. Because that's the work of man. But when God bears fruit, it's a different story. Okay? That's toiling. But we can step into blessing. Jesus could have said, yes, I can feed these people when we finally gather together 1 year's equal of wages to feed all these 3,000 people, because that's what the disciples said. They said, we don't have money. Where should we get the bread? But he produced from the life that was from within him.
Yes.
He really believed all things are subject to him. He believed even naturally the fish must hear him. Yet not because he desired, it's because the Father desired. So that's why his ears were all open to the Father. In Isaiah, he says, you have opened my ears that I may hear. So I believe we are corporately ready to put away everything that defiles our conscience, because we are coming to the understanding of who Jesus is and what his blood is. And we are not going to be saying, oh, only just I understand flesh of Jesus, the blood of Jesus. No, what does it mean to eat of his flesh? What does it mean to drink of his blood? What does it mean if I eat and drink, I will have life? What is life? What is death? What is God? Who am I? What is the devil? What is hell? We need to have answers to these questions. Otherwise, we walk in darkness, and those who walk in darkness do not know where they're going. I used this example 2 days ago when we arrived, that if we look at what we have in this room right now, in this house, we have many things. We have a board, we have chair, we have people, we have colors, we have light, many things. And every one of us sees everything that is in this place. True? Okay. Let's say among us, we had different level of sight. We have those that are farsighted. We have those that are nearsighted. We have those that are colorblind, and we have those that are completely blind. Everyone experiences the reality of this room according to their sight.
Yes.
Yeah.
But is the room changed?
No.
What has changed? Our sight. The way our eye sees. Some even see, but they're colorblind. They don't see the color. Some even see Jesus, but they don't see the smile on his face. Because they are farsighted, they think he's angry. He says, now we see dimly, but then we will see face to face. And he says, then, I mean when that which is perfect comes. And he says, the perfection is hope, faith, and love. But the greatest of these is love. So he says, when you see him in love, there is no obscurity, there is no veil, there is no darkness. You will never again say, but God did. No, see Jesus. See his face. You can never see the face of God except in the face of the Lord Jesus Christ. The glory of the Lord is shining from the face of Jesus Christ. This Lord is a spirit. You can never see him except in the spirit. John was in the spirit and he turned. And he saw a face shining like the sun. Revelation chapter 1. So, when we speak of walking with the Lord, that's the whole story of the Garden of Eden. They were supposed to walk with the Lord, and the only, I don't want to even use the word responsibility, but let's, for the sake of just lack of words, say the only responsibility that they had was to till and to keep, to guard the garden. To guard the garden. Because out of it goes forth either life or death. Depending on if you allow the serpent to come in or you allow the Lord to walk. So today I set before you life and death. Blessing and cursing. Good and evil. But I say, hear my voice, my son. Choose life, that both you and your descendants may live. For never again say, who shall ascend to the heaven, or who shall go beyond the sea. Not beyond the sea. He's speaking of heaven, earth, and the even level below the earth, which is the sea. The sea is the lower realm in the creation of God. So he says, don't ever again say, who shall go to heaven, or who shall go to the sea. Paul picks that up in Romans chapter 10. He says, hey, for everyone who believes, Christ is the end of the law for righteousness. For Moses wrote concerning the righteous which is according to the law in this way. Whoever wants to live this way, he will live if he does those things. But he says the same Moses spoke of another righteousness, which is the righteousness that we preach, the righteousness according to faith. And he says, this is what Moses said. It's in the same chapter, Deuteronomy chapter 30. He says, the righteousness that is of faith speaks this way. Doesn't speak this way. Who shall ascend into the heaven? He says, that's to bring Christ down from heaven. And who shall go? Not beyond the sea this time. This is Paul's interpretation. Into abyss. The bottomless pit. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. Then he gathered together the waters into a place called the sea. So he says, never again, when you are here, say who shall go here or go here. Paul says this is the abyss. Bottomless pit. He says, but this word that we preach is in your heart and in your mouth to speak. For with the heart one believes into righteousness. You're saying, I am as you are? Yes, I believe it. I just stepped to what I have always been. And it was locked in the bottomless pit of my heart. The place that I tried so hard to become something and always fell down back to that depth of darkness. Wow. He says, but this word, didn't he say, isn't what you say to ascend here, to go down here, is to bring Christ down and bring Christ up? He says, this story is your heart and your mouth. For within the heart you believe into and with the mouth I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. It's a word in my heart and in my mouth. For in it, the righteousness of God is revealed. the gospel of Christ. It is the power of God. It's not the power of man. It's not the work of man. It's not what I can do. It's not how I can do it. It's not how much I pray. It's not how much I fast. It's not how much good deeds I do. It's not how much I love you. None of those things. Those are all the fruits of who I have become. The gospel of Christ is the power of God that is able to descend into the abyss of my heart. And he showed that by coming out of heaven on earth, even going into the depth of the earth, to say, just as I did this naturally, I'm able to descend to the lowest part of your being and cleanse it and bring you up to take captivity captive and to give gifts to man. The gospel of Christ is the power of God unto salvation. Why? Because this begins to be revealed. We need a revelation of our righteousness. We need an unveiling of our righteousness. Because the revelation of righteousness is when the filthy rag of the fig leaves that we put around ourselves in the garden goes away. So I realize, before him, I always have been naked anyways. And then I come and eat from the tree of life. Why? Because the moment this happens, I realize, oh my goodness, he put the sword of cherubim to guard the way. Not to protect it from me. He made sure I have access to the tree of life. But he said, you will never be able to come with the fig leaves. I need to reveal your righteousness. So get away, filthy rags. Now come. And he says, the moment he does this, you realize and you say, okay, so how do I enter? He says, remember, I put the two cherubim. What did I put there? Cherubims, right? Says they had flaming Let's go to Psalm chapter 80. Do you feel the rest?
Yes.
And peace? In Psalm chapter 37, he says, in Isaiah chapter 66, he says to Zion, he says, I will extend peace like a river to you. And this peace, this river, is proceeding from the throne of the Lamb. Rose talked about this, the throne of the Lamb. And they pierced him. Water came out. When the centurion heard this, okay, I'm not going there. Because I want to teach today. Yesterday, it was all over, and I want you to have something to follow, some verses so you can follow. Psalm 80, verse 1. Give ear, O who? Shepherd of Israel, you who lead Joseph like a flock, you who dwell where? So who is here? Stir up, verse 2. Before Ephraim, Benjamin, and Manasseh, stir up your strength and come and save us. O shepherd of Israel, who dwell between the cherubim, come and save us. Who do you think is speaking when speaking to the shepherd? What does a shepherd do? So who is the one calling him the shepherd? The sheep. He's calling. Remember, whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So the sheep says, give ear, O shepherd of Israel, you who lead Joseph like a flock, you who dwell between the cherubim, shine forth. And then he says, stir up your strength and come and save us. Now let's go to John chapter 10. John chapter 10, verse 11. Verse 11. I am the good shepherd. Who is speaking? Jesus. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for the sheep. The sheep is calling to him, says, come, save us. He says, I'm the good shepherd. That was between the cherubim. When God put the sword to guard the way of the tree of life. The sheep says, I haven't gone in. I've gone astray. I'm outside. Would you come and save me from those who came before you and they were thieves and robbers? Because Jesus said, all who came before me were thieves and robbers. And the sheep did not hear their voice. But would you come and save me? The sheep says.
Hallelujah.
He says, yeah, I will come. I'm the good shepherd. But something first must happen. Let's go to Matthew chapter 27. Chapter 26 of Matthew, verse, let's read from verse 31. Then Jesus said to them, all of you will be made to stumble because of me this night. Which night? The night that they come to take away Jesus and crucify him. He says, all of you will be made to stumble. Now let's see who are all of them. It says, for it is written, so somewhere in the Old Testament this is written, I will strike the shepherd and the sheep of the flock will be scattered. So he says, the sheep was calling for the shepherd to come and save them. And yet he says, I will strike the shepherd and the sheep will be scattered. But the next verse says, but after I have been raised, I will go before you into Galilee. Galilee was his own city. Okay, let's see what he's trying to say. He says, there is a shepherd, and he will go later into Galilee, his own city, where he will lead his sheep in that place. What does a sheep need? The Lord is my shepherd. He will take me to waters, pastures. So he's taking people somewhere. And here he will feed them with fountain of water and with green pasture. So but they have to go in. And he says, but I will strike the shepherd. Why? Let's go to Zechariah chapter 13, where this is quoted from. Zechariah. Verse 6.
What chapter?
Chapter 13, verse 6, book of Zechariah. Okay. And one will say to him, now, we know, Jesus said everything that was written in the law, in the prophets, in the Psalms was written about me. Everything is fulfilled, so this must have been fulfilled. And this was quoted. And later he says in Matthew that this happened because they took him, and basically they took him to kill, and he says, don't touch my disciples, my sheep. And he says, that's why they were scattered. They have no sheep anymore. They have no shepherd anymore, and they have been scattered. So here he says, and one will say to him, what are these wounds between your arms? Then he will answer, those with which I was wounded in the house of my friends. What did he call Judas?
His friend.
He says, my friend, have you come? What have you come for? He says, I was wounded in my arms with those that are called my friends. Next verse. Awake, O sword. Which sword? God put cherubim with flaming swords to guard the way of the Garden of Eden. And Psalm said, you who dwell between the cherubim, you shepherd of Israel, come and save us. And he says, God said, this is what I will do. I will do this. But in order for you to be saved, you must enter here. Here, there are only thieves and robbers. But in order for me to do this, I must become your good shepherd. And when I become good shepherd, I will fulfill this prophecy that says, awake, O you sword, and strike the shepherd. Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. I will lay down my soul for the sheep. But when I'm raised, I will go before you into Galilee. Remember there was a Sea of Galilee? It calls that his own city. At the resurrection, he meets you in Galilee. That's a go there, I will meet you.
That's right.
We have come to this mountain. We have come to the shepherd of Israel. We have come to the blood of everlasting covenant. We can eat and drink in his presence. We can have the word of life and we can drink his spirit. We can eat of his flesh that was the word. And he can eat of the blood that was the life in that flesh. The word and the blood. The word and the spirit. Flesh and blood. If you eat of this flesh and drink of this blood, you shall never taste death. Why? Because he guarded a garden without the tree of knowledge of good and evil and without a serpent.
Wow. Right.
If you go here, there is no serpent.
Right.
Never again a garden with two trees.
Hallelujah.
But you must go through the door.
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Revelation chapter 4 says, finally, I who was in the spirit saw a door open already in the heaven.
Yes.
And one voice behind this door said, ascend here. Come up here. And I will show you things which must initiate from this place. And I saw a throne. And one sitting on the throne. His name is the Lamb, the Lord God, Almighty, the beginning and the end, the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last. I am the Lord God, and there is no, not one God beside me. I will provide myself a lamb for you, Abraham. I will never ask you for a son. I will never even give you my own son to you, if you believe that. I myself become flesh, and the flesh of the Spirit is the Son of God. I will not give you a lamb. I will provide myself as a lamb for you. I will come. The Lord is coming. Prophecy after prophecy after prophecy. The Lord is coming. The Lord is coming. The Lord is coming. The Lord is coming. Okay, let's read. Verse 7. Awake, O sword, against my shepherd, against the man who is my companion, says the Lord of hosts. Strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered. Then I will turn my hand against the little ones. And it shall come to pass in all the land, says the Lord, that two-thirds in it shall be cut off and die. You look at the revelation of Jesus Christ after the seals are opened by the Lamb, there are seven trumpets blown, and in every trumpet, one-third.
Yes.
One-third.
Yes.
One-third. And finally, he says, I saw a virgin woman. That finally the moon was under her feet and she was pregnant with the sun, S-U-N. The moon under her feet, she's pregnant. Sounds like the darkness is passing away and the true light is shining. Sounds like the day has come. The sun of righteousness is going to rise with wings of healings. Sounds like those who are being purified, the Lord descended into their temple and he sat down in their conscience and purified them like a silver and gold. He has caused them to come to a consciousness that they are about to ascend, not as the body of Christ anymore, but as the head of the Christ. So you can become part of the reigning and ruling Christ on earth with him for 1,000 years, a day of the Lord in the Spirit, when you can walk with the Lord. Wherever the Lamb goes, you follow him. Whatever place that had a defilement, the Lamb goes. And if we walk with him, if we are in the light, just as he is in the light, we walk with him and the blood of Christ cleanses us from all unrighteousness. Every spot that any place that had, that was in, will be purged. As they walk, things are going away, and they are, he says, they had no deceit in their mouth anymore. Why? Because the righteousness is revealed in the heart and their words coming out of righteousness. They do not say who shall go or who shall descend. The word is ascending from within.
Yes, yes.
And because of this, they're bringing, as the 144,000 first fruits of the tree of life that has 12 branches, 12 months of the year, 144, 12 multiplied by 12, and 1,000, which is a day, one day, a tree of life that has 144,000 fruits, and they are being eaten by others.
Yes.
So you can become the scroll open, known and read by all men. I saw scrolls open. Not anymore closed. Because we are not ministers of the new covenant written on tablets of stone, but ministers of the new covenant. And who is sufficient for all these things? But it is he who has enabled us to become the ministers of the spirits. We write in your heart, in your conscience, not by ink, but by the finger of God, the Spirit of the Holy One. So we write in your heart, you are free. The law of the Spirit of Christ, the law of the Spirit of life in Christ has set me free from the law of sin and death. We are ministers of the new covenant.
Yes.
But even if this gospel is veiled to do, it is veiled to those who are perishing, who do not believe. That's why they don't believe. So we don't hold anything against anyone. We just walk in the light. And we remain the light. And finally, they will see the light of the city.
Yes.
And because our gate is open, never closed,
yes.
And he says, the gates are open every day in parentheses, for there is no darkness in there, for there is no night in there.
Yeah.
Every day, you're the light, you're open, and then they see, they say, I have a father, that even in his house, all the hired ones have something to eat and to spare.
Yes.
Abundance. Let me go into the house of the Lord,
yes.
Into the city of my God.
Yes.
Isaiah chapter 2 says, it shall come to pass in the latter days that the mountain of the house of the Lord will be established on top of all mountains, and every nation shall flow into it. And they shall say, yes. Let us come and go to the mountain of the Lord, for he will save us.
Yes.
He will bless us.
Yes.
The sheep that were scattered, they finally see the door is open.
Yes.
Let us go. Let us go and keep the feast.
Yes.
Let us go and keep the feast of tabernacle. Let us dwell in his presence. Eat of his flesh. Drink of his blood. Let us rejoice. It's a day of celebration. It's a feast of joy and thanksgiving. This is the Lord that the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. We shall be glad and rejoice in it. So rejoice in the Lord. Sing psalms to one another. Make a melody in your heart to this Lord in the name, to Jesus in the name of the Lord. What does that mean? This is the Lord you have been waiting for. There is no other Lord. And no one without the Spirit of God can say Jesus Christ is the Lord.
That's right.
So don't try to make anyone to say Jesus is Lord. Don't make them to pray a prayer to say Jesus is Lord. Be the Lord to them. Be the shepherd that lays down his life for them. And they will go through you because you have now become the gate. Because on the gates of the city, the 12 gates, were written the name of the 12 sons of Israel. Sons, not children. Sons who have become the gates of their father, Israel, for all other nations. They were supposed to be a kingdom of priests for all nations, not for themselves. We are not priests. We are not supposed to be priests to one another. We are supposed to be teachers, shepherds, prophets, apostles, evangelists. But you are supposed to be a priest and a king to the nations. You don't go begging. You are in the order of Melchizedek.
Yes.
You are king of righteousness.
Yes.
You are the king of Salem, which means king of peace.
Yes.
Blessed are those who are peacemakers, for they shall be children of God. Now, sons of God, but what kind of peace? Like, let us come and celebrate. We are all believing the same thing. No, even a sword will pierce through your own soul. Because I didn't come to bring peace, I came to bring sword. But where does this sword go into? Into your soul. So where is he taking peace from? The false peace that your soul had made.
Yes.
And God says to the prophets of Israel, he says, you have prophesied falsely. You have said peace when there is no peace. When I spoke the word, you should have spoken the word that I gave you, not out of the dictates of your own heart. Because the true peace comes when I cut that which is uncircumcised in your heart.
Yes.
Unbelief.
Yeah.
Believe and you enter into rest.
Yes.
So when we say peacemakers, peacemakers are those who, you know, those who you haven't. Obviously, this is not a Muslim or Jewish country. Circumcision is not big here. But back home, we had this. So when they do the circumcision, they have to distract the one that is being circumcised, the child, so they can do it quickly. That's what the Lord does in the heart. Circumcises the heart from unbelief. And if you are willing, he does that. So every word that comes from the cross is able to do that. Because it just removes everything. He said, no one can enter into the strong man's house unless he first removes his arm. Because through the arm he had guarded himself. He says, but the arms must be taken away first and then he can come in. So he's circumcising so he can come in and sit. Look at verse 9. Chapter 13 of Zechariah. Yeah. I will bring the one third through the fire, will refine them as silver is refined. And test them as gold is tested. They will call on my name, and I will answer them. I will say, this is my people. And each one will say, the Lord is my God. They never again have that God that they had made for themselves in their heart. The image that they had made for themselves. And this is a promise. These are all prophecies. He says, these shall come to pass. Now, I can step to every one of these prophecies right now. Because Rose read this in Acts chapter 13. It says, every prophecy that God had made to our forefathers, he has fulfilled in one man. So now I can have hope that I can say, okay, now I understand every prophecy. What does it mean? And I want it. I step into this, I step into this, I step into this, I follow the Lamb, I step, I step, I step. So when Jesus authored the faith, he didn't leave it halfway through. He perfected the faith. But everyone who was before him, he says, although they, by faith, their life became a testimony of what the Lord can do, but they all died. But this one was raised from the dead. He finished the faith.
Awesome.
What was the perfecting of the faith? The perfecting of what God is able to do in a man. He believed to the point of resurrection. That has become now a cloud from which rain can come upon me. I'm surrounded by this cloud of witnesses that their life has been witnessed, but now he is the faithful witness. And I receive from him. So I don't live by my faith. I live by the faith of the one who died for me and he raised for me. So I don't look at myself. I look at him and I walk. I put my feet in the steps of him who walked. And I find myself where he is. Not by efforts. I have opened my ears to hear. And he leads me as a good shepherd. I am his shepherd and I hear his voice. Now, why sometimes I don't hear? Because I'm not listening to the shepherd. I'm listening to the thieves and robbers. Jesus said, all who came before me, thieves and robbers. Who are alls? Do you think anyone being excluded? Who came before Jesus? Name. a few. Moses, Abraham, Isaiah. In Islam, they were all holy people, which means they have never done any wrong. They were created that way, and they had no ability to commit sin. When I read the Bible, and it talked about Jacob deceiving, and Abraham lying, and Judah sleeping with his daughter-in-law, and I'm like, this is crazy. This is blasphemy. These are holy people. He says, yet in God's eyes, no man can boast before him.
Yeah.
Not even Abraham. For what did Abraham do? He says he believed only. That's it.
Yeah.
And he was then called a friend of God. So he believed. And now in our story, this is what we do. We only believe, and according to our faith, it will be done to us. Yet not our faith. He said, have the faith of God. Which means he's the one who sees the beginning and the end. So if he knows the end from the beginning, he has declared the end from the beginning. These are all verses from Isaiah. And that's when he says, I am the beginning and the end. And Jesus comes and says, I am the beginning and the end. That means I have declared the end from the beginning. So I am your end. From now, walk with me.
Yes.
I will lead you. Abraham, you've been in this place, but come out of your family. Come out of your city. Come out of your nation. Leave everything behind. Paul said, I have left everything behind. So now follow me, I will take you to another place. Paul says that I may attain to the resurrection of the dead. Not that I have already attained. So leave everything that you know. Everything that Masood has said, or Rose has said, or Pastor Vin has said, or so-and-so have said, or your thought have said. Discern the voice of the Lord. He is your good shepherd. Who are we? We are ourselves sheep. And he said, shepherd one another. That means, in order to be a shepherd, the word pastor is actually shepherd. Now, Pastor Vin, no offense. This, no, for the sake of others. Because he's the one that actually has gone before us and has eaten from something that is so gracious, and he comes and shares that with us.
Yes.
But all that he has is from the Lord. All I have is from the Lord. All you have is from the Lord.
Yes.
And he said, minister the grace that you have received to one another.
Yes.
So you are your own shepherds.
Yes. Yes.
So why do you create a hierarchy?
Right.
That someone is here, someone is there, someone is there, and someone is there. And then the people that sit here and listen to this, they feel like, what a man of God.
Right.
No. I will never draw your attention to myself. I will draw your attention to the one who is able to save your soul.
Amen.
I will show you the way, but you will walk in it.
Yeah.
When you hear him. He's your shepherd. And he's able. And we bear witness of this to the level that we have handled and touched and seen, that you may also have fellowship with us in this world of life. And truly our fellowship is with the Son, with the Father and his Son. So we are a family. So let all the burden go. Take a breath.
Wow.
Even your breath is given by him.
Yeah.
The reason you can breathe is himself.
Yes.
For his name is called
Yahweh. Yes. That's right.
You inhale and exhale him.
Yeah.
That's right.
So take a deep breath and eat and drink of him. Do it.
Yeah.
You don't need to even move your lips. It's your breath. That's how you call on his name. Every time you take a breath, you're calling upon the name of the Lord. But yet make this so easy that we can't miss it. So put yourself in the mystery constantly. Put yourself in this mystery, in this process. If you go astray, then minister to one another. Because, and love one another, for love covers a multitude of sin.
Yes.
And he will take, or basically save a soul from his error.
Yes.
The word error means the one who has gone again astray.
Yes.
It's the same exact word. The same that is being, the word that is being translated as being deceived.
Yes.
So this deception means you haven't believed the truth about yourself. So you are deceived when you don't hear the voice that saves you. So don't say when you are being tempted, I'm being tempted and tested by the Lord. It's a lie. From the non-existing hell. Don't say ever the Lord has tempted me. Don't ever say the Lord has given and the Lord has taken away.
Yes.
Ever. For do not be deceived, my brethren. Every good gift comes from above, from the Father of lights, of whom you are his children of light. Don't ever. Every other wisdom is earthly, sensual, and demonic.
Yes.
But that which comes from above is first of all pure, peaceable, gentle, full of good fruits. Now the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace by those who are able to make peace with the Lord in their heart. So sow the seed and it will bear fruit. Ask and you shall receive. For Elijah was a man like us. He was from Florida. He was eating the same Italian food. The same oil. Olive oils. And then one day he decided, it's not going to rain. And it didn't rain. And again he did ask for rain and it rained. He said, therefore, remember the prayer of the righteous avails much, does something, but sow it in peace.
Yes.
Sow it in peace. Don't say the Lord is that way, the Lord is that way. That's another Jesus.
Yes.
Don't use your experiences or their experiences to form who God is and worship that image. That's another Jesus. Walk with him in the light. Don't say, well, you have sinned, you have to do this. No, look at Jesus. Be merciful, be compassionate, be so tender toward people that they can't stop but to come and listen to you.
Yes. Yes.
And as they are around you, the voice of a multitude will come out of you like the sound of many waters. Where John says, Jesus was baptizing in a place that was many waters. The sound, the voice was like many waters. So they, when they sit beside you, they're being baptized.
Wow.
And their conscience is being immersed by the water that you're sending toward them like the flood of Noah. And they are being exalted as the ark of the Lord. And they're being saved out of their unrighteousness. It's the love. There will come a time that the, it is the time that the children of God will live by hope, faith, and love. And the greatest of these is love. And they know how to speak, not because they judge what is wrong and what is right, but because they hear. Because the Lord has opened their ears and they discern instead of judging. So when they hear something, it's not for their destruction. And you say, unless you do this, this will not happen. Well, they had their own time. They had their own chance. They lost their chance. Don't say that way. He's able to restore.
Yes.
His power is greater than man's weakness. His ability is to save is more and greater than man's ability to be lost. He's able. He's able to do all things. He's able to make all things new. He's able to make all nations come and worship before him. He's able to cause all grace to abound toward you, that you may always have an abundance in every good works. Is this the God we know, or and stingy?
This is the God we know.
Okay. This is the God we know. I don't even want to know the name of the other God. This is the God. This is God. So, but it seems like my life is like, okay, don't look at your life. Don't look. Look unto Jesus. When you see things not happening, when you see things not being subjected to you, they are subjected to him at least. So look unto him. For he made you to, and he crowned you and with honor and glory, and he subjected everything to you. But you don't see yet all things subject to you. But you are able to see Jesus. He's your high priest. Look unto him. He's able to make a way out of every temptation. Why? Because he shows you. I was tempted to believe that God does the same, that people had said that you must keep the stony law to make bread for yourself. But then I realized, I hear the voice, he said, you're my son. And I stood in that, and I realized that thought left me after 40 days. And I have come and I say, ask the Father for bread. For everyone who asks, receives. But I did it and it didn't happen. But I see Jesus.
Yes.
I never argue with the voice that says, did God really say?
Yeah.
Because that creates confusion. I never ask for any reason why something didn't happen. Never, ever. I always want, what is God going to answer? Well, you know, this so-and-so and that devil and that thing, they were all super powerful that I wasn't able to. I never argue with that voice. I say, okay, I keep it here. I see Jesus. What did you show in your humanity? What did you believe about the Father? Who was the Father to you? And what did he do according to what you believed? Say, okay, so I'm being saved. I have a way out of that temptation. So that's why I don't allow the things outside to move me, my experiences, other people's experiences, the amazing teachings of the church about how God, through this broken leg, taught me this. I will never look onto those things. I will close my doors to every one of them. I will go to the secret place. And I say, my Father who is in heaven.
Yes.
Your name must be sanctified from any false god that I had already believed.
Yes.
Your kingdom. You reign.
Yes.
Your name be on me.
Yes.
And deliver me from this wicked heart or conscience of unbelief. I don't want to be in this. And now give me the bread.
Oh, that's beautiful.
That's how you pray.
Yeah.
For yours is the glory.
Yes.
For yours is the power.
That's how Jesus taught.
That's how Jesus said, pray. Can I go for a few more minutes?
Yes.
No?
Yes.
Yes. Can we go to Psalm chapter 37? Actually, let's go to chapter 36. Chapter 36, verse 7. How precious is your loving kindness, O God. The word loving kindness is the word mercy. Okay, somehow they have translated as loving kindness. And you know Jesus was constantly asked for mercy. Have mercy on us. And every time they asked for mercy, he did something. Yeah. Okay, he healed the sick. He cast out what was tormenting them. Now here he says, how precious is your mercy, O God. And then he says, therefore the children of men put their trust under the shadow of your wings. They put their trust under the shadow of your wings. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. But Jesus said, when you want to pray, go to the secret place. So where is the shadow of the Almighty?
Within.
And he says, when you go inside and you take your trust, not on the outward gods, but in the inner God,
yes,
the Lord, the Holy Spirit that is inside of you. When you live under that shadow, when your hope is that mercy that can flow from him. The tabernacle of Moses had something called the Ark of the Covenant. On top of it was the mercy seat, and above it were the cherubim of the glory, the wings.
Yes.
Okay. We practiced this yesterday. We said, okay, we close our eyes, we go within, we go under the shadow of the Almighty, we sit on the mercy seat, I'm putting my trust between the cherubim.
Yes.
Where the blood of the Good Shepherd is shed. That's why the door is open there. Remember, the sheep called upon him and he said, come and save us. And he said, your salvation is not here, it's here. You must enter. And he said, in order for you to enter, the gate must be open. And the gate will be open when I lay down my life. So the blood is shed here.
Yes.
So the mercy seat, where the blood was sprinkled. Once again, he says, how precious is your mercy, O God? For the children of men put their trust under the shadow of your wings. They know something about your ability to save. And they no longer go around looking for salvation, looking for pasture or waters. They go through the shepherd. Who is the shepherd? Jesus Christ. What does a shepherd that was stricken mean? Crucifixion. So how do you go in? Through his flesh. And how are able to go through the flesh when the blood is being sprinkled on your conscience. Hebrews says, no one will come or draw to God unless his conscience is being cleansed. That's why under the Old Testament, the priests would not dare to go into the most holy place. They always ministered in the holy place. But he says, now you come boldly and enter into the holiest, into the most holy,
yes,
having the blood of Jesus. So everything goes around the crucifixion of Christ, where all the mysteries begin to be unveiled. And when you go every time, every scripture, through that door, when you go through the Lamb who is able to open the scroll, every time that you go through this, you will see an entrance into a realm beyond you. That's why your trust can go there. That's why Hebrews 6 says we have a hope that goes beyond the veil. From holy to the most holy, beyond the veil. Even though I'm here, but my hope goes beyond there. And it says it becomes an anchor that takes me into itself. So how precious is that mercy that the children of men put this hope into this place, because you are able to bring them. Let's see what happens if this happens. Verse 8, they are abundantly satisfied with the fullness of your house. Sounds like a house, the children of the Lord. This is that the house that the Lord has prepared for us. The house of sons of the same Father. And the Father has riches, his fullness. And they shall be satisfied with this fullness. And you give them drink from the river of what?
Your pleasures.
So when you put your hope, your trust under the shadow, so you are here, you're not there, your hope goes on the Ark of the Covenant between the cherubim.
Whoa.
You're not there. And when you put your hope, the hope is able to bring you in. So Abraham, against all hope, in hope he believed. And he says, if that happens, then in that most holy place, it's the fullness of the Lord's house, and you shall be satisfied. Why? Because the ark was also called the throne.
Yes.
Revelation says, out of the throne proceeds the pure water of the river of life. From the throne, pure, where the blood is being sprinkled, water comes. So when I go in, then I can drink from a water that is no longer muddy, doesn't have any dust. It's not addition. It's not contaminated. There is no pollution. It's pure. It proceeds from the mouth of God, and man shall live by it. So when you put your trust, he's able to take you in. And he says, you will drink from the river of his pleasure. This is the story of the Garden of Eden.
Yes.
This is the garden that God made. And he said, Adam, you're not in Eden. You are in the garden that is in Eden. Okay? Eastward in Eden, God planted a garden. The garden is the soul. Okay, so you are put in the soul, and then there is a river coming from Eden to you. Drink of this. There is a water coming out of the pleasure of God.
Whoa.
So open your mouth, which is actually your heart, to drink from this water. So anytime, any moment, I've been there, we've been there, we still at times have this, that it sounds like something for the future, because the reality of your life daily is not this. Okay? But Jesus says, fear not. Do not fear. Do not fear. What I'm telling you is the truth. So go into your secret place. Practice this. Close your eyes. Forget about everything around you. Don't try to fix what is not fixable. Put your trust in the one who is able to save. And don't ask for what you don't want. Ask for what you want. Don't say, I don't want this stone. Say, I want bread. Okay. Don't say, what if I bring the sacrifice and then you can do something for me? Don't do it. Don't trade for it. Don't pay money till you receive money. Don't sow fleshly. Put your trust. You are heir. You don't receive according to sowing and reaping. Okay? You receive according to the inheritance. Otherwise, you are not under the new covenant, the new testament, the promise of eternal inheritance. But when you receive, then you're able to give. So put your trust in the Lord who is able to give you both seed and the bread. And he says to the church of Corinth, he says, it's amazing, this grace that we have discovered with this church at Macedonia, I think. He says, out of their poverty, something happened. They became rich. And he says, I'm ministering this to you so you can also partake of this grace. There is such a thing. It's not that the Lord wants you to suffer. It's not that the Lord wants you to humble you. It's not the Lord that is testing you because of the situation that you are in. It's that you live in this world, and in this world, he said, is tribulation. But take heart, I have overcome the world. So come to the one who has overcome the world, and you can overcome by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of your testimony, not trying to save your soul, but to have an anchor for your soul that goes beyond the veil into the Holy of Holies. And in that place, he's able to save you. And he says, when they realized this, they were not anymore focused on around their poverty and all of that. In their meditation, they realized, I'm not bound by these things. And they gave. But when they gave, it wasn't because they wanted to receive. He says, actually, they didn't. He says, therefore, do not do for covetousness. It's translated as grudgingly, I think. It's covetousness. What is covetousness? He says, don't do it that way. But what you do, he says, with a generous heart, you give. Why? Because he says, don't try to make this work. Okay, what I'm trying to say. He says, this is a revelation of a grace that they received, and I'm preaching, so may the Lord give you understanding also in this, which is they came to a place that in the realm of the Spirit, they saw their abundance instead of their lack in this realm. And that caused the unseen to manifest. They became rich. I don't believe in poverty. Just as I don't believe in sickness, just as I don't believe in death, just as I don't believe in sin, just as I don't believe in temptation, I believe the Lord. And the Lord will not use evil to make me know him. The Lord will talk to me and I will know him. The Lord will not chastise me with those things. The Lord will chastise me with his word. The Lord will train me like a son. The Lord will give me wisdom. Yes. The Lord will give me instruction. The Lord will give me understanding. The Lord will give me knowledge. The Lord will give me discernment. These are the fruits, the gifts of the Spirit. These are the things that make me to grow out of childhood into maturity of sonship. Yes. Okay? So now he says, verse 9, for with you is the fountain of life. Yes. What is the thing or the death or the lack or sickness that the fountain of life is not able to handle? I mean, what's the point of, if it was all something spiritual, what's the point of our flesh? Let's just think about this. What's the place of our flesh if it was only about we sitting down and just trying to be spiritual? What does even spirituality mean? Isn't it that the Spirit will search the deep things of God and reveal them to us, and the spiritual man receives this and he walks in the way of the Lord. He goes into the pleasure of the Lord, and he's the good one who gives all things according to his goodness and his riches, not according to my poverty. So if I live in a situation that doesn't reflect his abundance, I'm deceiving myself. It's not God. Now, if I am in poverty and sickness and death, it doesn't mean I'm being deceived. But if I believe in those things, I'm deceived. What does it mean? It means when those things happen, my eyes are still on the Lord to save me. Paul says, I don't want you, my brethren, to be unaware of what happened to us, that we were in such a great death that even I, who am preaching to you life and immortality, I had the sentence of death in myself. But the Lord raised me, so that my trust may not be in myself, but in God who raises the dead. For he delivered me, and he still delivers me, and I trust in him that he will deliver me again. That's the confidence of sons of God. That's the confidence that says, do not throw away your confidence, for it has great reward. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 36, maybe. And the just shall live by faith. But if anyone draws back, my soul has no pleasure. Why? Because the pleasure is coming from this side. When I put my trust in him, but when the soul goes away, the Lord gives and the Lord takes away. Wrong. Don't even sing that song. You're tempting the Lord in your wilderness. Okay? So, walk with him in the spirit of the day, with the voice of the Lord, and that voice will lead you. It will, it shall, it does. It's the truth. That's the only truth. The voice of the Spirit is the only truth that you can ever have. He says, there are three witnesses on earth that bear witness. The blood, the water, and the Spirit. Or let me put it this way. He says, this is he who came by blood, Jesus Christ. Not by water only, by water and blood. And it is the Spirit who bears witness. And the Spirit is the truth. He says he has given us so many witnesses that we can believe him. Yes. Not the things that we have already seen. That what he has seen, he can testify. So I can be free from what I have seen. So that what is unseen can become my reality. Because faith is the conviction of things unseen. And faith does something. So let us have the understanding of a focused understanding toward the cross, toward the Christ that was crucified, and let him become the door to every good thing that is beyond the veil, beyond the flesh, so we can bring out of the realm of the Spirit into the realm of flesh. Make sense?
Yes.
Okay, so can we just quickly pray? If you would just to stand, just in agreement, not that this does anything or there is any power behind it. Just to realize that we are standing on Zion, that we are in the city, that we are the spirits that are made perfect, that we are in the presence of the Lord himself, Jesus Christ, that he is a witness to everything that we see, we hear, and we speak today. And he shall confirm his word with signs, wonders and miracles, so that this may not be the word of man, but the power of God. Okay? So, Father, we thank you for truth. We thank you that just as we were gone astray at once, but now we have returned to the shepherd of our soul, that our thirst is for you, and we shall never thirst because there is always abundance to drink from this river of pleasure that is coming toward us. Thank you that we are being made righteous. Thank you that we are perfect. Thank you that we are your sons, that we are the blessed of the Most High. Thank you that we are the heirs of the heaven and the earth. And thank you that everything that you have is ours.
Yes.
Everything that you have is mine, and everything that is mine is yours. And thank you that this flesh, this body, is the place you shall be glorified in.
Yes.
This is the place that you will manifest yourself, that we can say, if you have seen me, you have seen the Father. If you have known me, you have known the Father, because we have been blessed by the abundance of your goodness, your love, your mercy, your compassion, your righteousness, your holiness, that they can't see us anymore, but they can see the one that is inside of us. And the one that is inside of us is I, myself. Yet not I, but Christ, that has become my new I. I am one with Christ. I am joint heir with Christ. I am your heir, and I am the heir of the inheritance. Lord, we thank you. We give you thanks for every blessing that is coming to this house. We thank you for abundance that is coming to this house. We thank you for everything that is flowing to this house. We thank you for children that are being raised in this house. Children under your anointing, under your voice, under your power, under your authority, that they may become your kingdom, that you reign inside of them. You reign in their consciousness, that you become the one who gives them life, that you bring new ideas, new plans, new way of doing things. We thank you for even every place that seems to be a place of lack, that your abundance is able to overflow everything, that there is always an abundance for every good work. And thank you, Lord, that this house would become a hub for nations, that the word of truth will go out of this place, that the word of Christ would internationally transform, change, and bring a radical experience of the Lord himself. And thank you that just even now the word is already going forth. Thank you that you bring sheep that are thirsty to hear and to eat from your word to this house. And thank you that you are able to do these things. And this is not that any man may be glorified, but it is that our kingdom may be known on earth by men, and everyone can flow into this. Thank you for abundance even in people's finances. Thank you that if there is any need in any aspect of their finances, every one of them is met according to your riches and your abundance, not according to their lack. We don't ask for sufficiency, we ask for abundance. And we are not ashamed of this. We set our hope in you, because we are not trying to make this to happen. We delight ourselves in you. And we thank you that businesses will thrive. We thank you that new jobs would come in. We thank you that new partners would come in. We thank you that new contracts would come in. And we thank you that all of these things will not be the focus of anybody's life. They will never become their God, but you shall remain God in everyone's eye. And yet, you are not our God, you are our Father. And we thank you that we can celebrate you today as one children, as one body, as one family, and every one of us can look into our spirit, go beyond the flesh, and have love for one another. In the name of the only true God, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
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 Amen.